gentlemen, we are meeting somebody that we already know from this morning, but you met Barry Brown as he was one of our panelists. Now he will talk about a concept that I'm very curious to hear him frame. Reality mining. Reality mining, what is that? Barry is, as he mentioned, a professor of human-computer interaction at the University of Stockholm and quite a seasoned academic in his field. So a warm hand for Barry Brown.
I'm going to talk about three things today. So I'm going to take you on a little trip up to Stockholm, and I'm going to take you into the research center that we have in Stockholm, which is based around trying to invent new consumer IoT solutions. And consumer IoT is the challenging area. It's exciting in lots of ways, but it's always been a very challenging area for IoT. There's been some successes, but of course many, many failures. I'm going to focus in particular on one project, which I think is really a really interesting one, which is called reality mining, which is about the opportunities that IoT sensors give us to do really interesting applications, useful applications, and let's be honest, perhaps also really scary applications. Because the idea that sensors can be enabled everywhere, that every single one of our phones that we have in our pockets or bags here can be an active mic, there's some scary aspects of that as well. So in the last part of the talk, I'm really going to focus in on some of those fears and think a little bit about how we might deal with them. OK, but let me take you a short jaunt north to Stockholm. This is our research center. We're called Mobile Life. We've been running for 10 years. And we're sort of a mix of industry and academic collaboration. We have some of the kind of well-known Swedish companies, also some sort of less well-known smaller companies who actually are sometimes a little bit better at keeping us on our feet and keeping us honest in some way. And our focus has always been in the center on building systems that are pleasurable. We really have this this problem, which we think that, let's be honest, nobody goes to university to have fun. They're not known as the most fun places in the world, but if technology, consumer IoT is going to be successful, it has to be fun in some way. The center is also distinctive. It's a computer science research center. We're in our computer science department. And of course, we have a lot of techies. And I myself am a computer scientist, so this is obviously has to be the kind of core of any research in this area. But I don't need to tell you that that's not enough. You can build low-power hardware until the end of the world, but if you don't have other competencies, like, for example, design, where are you going to be? So this is some work, for example, that uses precious metals and tries to combine IoT with precious metals like gold and silver. And a third of the researchers in our center are actually designers, along with the one third who are technologists. And then we've also got this other one third that are social scientists, because we believe that if we're really going to try and create new inventions, we actually need to understand deep human values. And Alexandra's talk earlier was just incredibly inspiring, that she's caught onto something that actually talks to a real human value, rather than perhaps just creating increasing numbers of kind of complex toys, is really focusing in on something I think that connects with humans. So our center's got this one third, one third, one third. As well as innovating on how we're put together, we also try and innovate a little bit in how we publicize and output our research. So with IKEA, who are one of our longer standing partners, we worked on this. This is a design fitchin. This is a an imaginary IKEA catalog from 20 years in the future. And you can go into our website and download that and some of our other design fitchins. This was part of us exploring not just, so IKEA's innovation hasn't just been that they make interesting furniture, it's been that they've always innovated on how they get those products to customers and what customers do when they get them. You have to assemble it yourself. So we tried to experiment a little bit with that, with imagining what the future might be for IKEA. So, for example, in the corner there is a bookshelf that you can buy that would have automatic deliveries of books, new books to your bookshelf that can presumably go and sit there unread. Now, As well as communicating our research, our main focus, though, has always been on trying to design, build, and test new innovative solutions. And I think we really are pioneers in a number of areas. So health is one that, of course, is a really hot interest. And about 8 years ago, we started experimenting with body-worn sensors. This was a system that used a galvanic skin response sensor. And feeding the results from those sensors back to individuals so they could see themselves their long-term body patterns. Nothing really very exciting really about that. Nowadays, you see those kind of those sort of applications really are very mainstream now. But there's one thing I think that didn't carry across. For many people, this kind of tracking and feeding back of your own patterns doesn't actually have a positive contribution to health. For many who are, say, stressed or have problems with workload, just giving you another target, another thing that you have to keep track of, doesn't help you deal with those problems. So actually, in our health work, we've really broken with this model of tracking and then feeding back. We're trying to explore designs that I think work in quite different ways. So this is a system called the Soma Carpet. And I'm kind of hopeful that the video might work. And you'll see really quite how different this is from, I think, many of the current generation of systems that are supporting well-being. Okay. So while the video is loading up, I'm just going to tell you a little bit about it. Soma Carpet uses heat as its main interface. It's a carpet that has heat sensors on it, sensors and heat production, and at different parts of the mat heat up to guide you through a guided relaxation session. Let me try and play the video. So I might need a little bit of help from the AV just to see if you could go back and maybe wait a few seconds. I think it takes a while to load. So the Soma Carpet is kind of an interesting set of ideas. Firstly, because it uses heat as a user interface. We don't normally think of heat as being something that our systems can produce. But also because it's built around this idea of helping you in a guided relaxation. So you lie on the mat guides you through a relaxation through heating up different sections of the mat. And after you actually have a guided relaxation program, and then after a while, you can actually just lie down on the mat, and the heat in different sections of the mat then guides you through that relaxation. Any chance of getting that video? It doesn't look like it's going to work. So you'll have to check that one out on the website, I'm afraid. So sorry about that. These things happen. So we produce many of these IoT systems. There are these IoT experiments. That's looking promising. Do you think? Sometimes I think, you know, the computer wants a round of applause as well, so it can kind of. I just had a device failure just minutes before I went up on stage here, so this is one of those nervous points. I think we're just gonna have to carry on. But the Soma Carpet's really interesting IoT device, and also we're talking to IKEA about possibly productizing that because it fits in with their expanding smart lighting division. Okay. So many of these IoT systems that we've developing produce huge amounts of data. We've got very interested in, well, what can you actually do with that data? And increasingly, what some of the challenges that having systems that are collecting data give for you. I mentioned that one third of the researchers in our center are social scientists, and they've got very interested in the ability to build small sensor packs that people can wear. So this is a little sensor pack that has cameras on it. It has we can fit cameras at different angles. It has long life batteries in it, so it'll last for about 40 hours. And it allows somebody to wear a little pack that will record video of everything they're doing, of their everyday life. So we took this little sensor pack, and one of the first things that we did with that was we put it on people who were Apple Watch users, early adopters of smartwatches, and we could record every interaction that they did with an Apple Watch. with a clever little bit of image analysis and some manual analysis as well, we managed to go through and code all the times that they were using the Apple Watch. And so we got a chance to look at some numbers for how many times people use Apple Watches, what they use those Apple Watches for. A French newspaper had quite a nice headline, newsflash, Apple Watch used to tell time. And that's because actually one of the things we found was the main use of smartwatches is to tell the time. Now, of course, you can give people sensor packs, and you can use that to collect data. But as I mentioned at the beginning there, we all have these advanced little sensor systems already that we're carrying around with us. Our phones, for example, are recording where we go and those interactions sometimes that we have. If you have an iPhone, I don't know if you know this, you can actually dig in and it'll record where you've been for the last month. So if you go through these settings here, you can get this little map here which will show you everywhere you've been where you've carried your phone in the last month. So we've exploited that to also use phones as sensor packs. So we've been doing some experiments where we record everything that goes on around the mobile phone, all your interactions on the screen with the phone. And this gives us this really nice perspective on people's everyday life. We can sort of study a little bit some of the interactions that are taking place. One of the sociologists on this project got very excited because he said this was the first time you could ever collect data from people when they were in bed, because perhaps they're pulling out their phone to have a conversation with their partner just before they go to sleep. And by recording what was going on the screen and the audio around, with their permission, we got this chance to kind of look at aspects of their everyday life that we'd normally never get to look at. So now that's one kind of interesting thing, because that's very fine for social scientists, but perhaps the kicker is the possibility that we can use that data to plug it back into how systems work. Can we use IoT devices, ones that are either worn, that are custom made, or that we already carry, as in our mobile phones, can we use that to plug that back into how our systems work? And this is an approach that's known as reality mining. We didn't coin the phrase. It's actually two professors at MIT, Eagle and Green, who came up with this concept. But it's a real kind of interesting opportunity, I think, to think about how we might mine people's everyday reality through sensors to try and change how systems work. So some of the projects that we've worked on, for example, we've used the similar techniques to do continuous speech recognition. So the idea behind this is that your mobile phone might be, say, for example, listening all the time and running that through speech recognition. So it could do things like, for example, if you're talking about a particular city, it could prime the text completion features that you have on your phone because it's picked up that you've said that. And we've been doing work where we get people to wear microphones and then feed that back through speech recognition systems to try and see what kind of concepts we can draw out of that to aid how systems work. If you've done anything with speech recognition, you know it's a really difficult area, and getting good results out of what is essentially ambient audio is quite challenging. So while we got some way with that, we've actually moved on and also tried to look a little bit at activity recognition. So this is a little sensor pack, a long life battery, a commodity mobile phone in a waterproof bag. We placed this next to a forest, which is just a little bit away from where our offices are. And using the microphone and a little bit of machine learning, we could detect when people were walking along that path. So we could get quite accurate footfall estimates for forest paths without having to put anything over the forest path or perhaps visibly instrument the forest path in any way. And we're not the only ones to do this. There's also been some startups that have explored a little bit doing this kind of work. There's one company that will pay you to stick a mobile phone in your window, and they use that to actually work at how many people are walking past on the street. And they're also interested in this kind of detecting footfall traffic. See, that's one of the videos there, people going past. You can see that it can recognize what's going on. When you're doing these sort of systems, it's kind of quite different from just sort of low energy kind of IoT probes, because you have to do some sort of media processing. So often we've found that many of the platforms that you use for kind of low energy IoT really can't compress or do basic recognition on the sort of data that we've coming in. So actually, we often fall back to using techniques like just store and retrieve, where we'd store the data and then we'd actually go and physically retrieve the data from one of these devices. But I think the holy grail for us, and not just us just now, is the possibility that one might combine multiple sensors, put them together, use recognition techniques. And there's really quite high accuracy that has been shown in recognition of household activities anyway, if you have this chance of combining multiple sensor feeds. Are you getting scared yet? So, I grew up in Scotland, and one of the lessons I learned growing up in Scotland was never trust adults. And some of this technology does make me at least a little bit scared. We're all familiar with many of the big IoT-related security and data loss events. We heard about some of them this morning. So for example, the well-known Target one, where the CEO actually resigned. Actually, not many know that there was actually one of the vectors that they used was essentially an IoT vector. There was a vulnerability in one of the air conditioning companies that had a certificate to Target's network, and from that, they got access to the Target cash registers, and so that was actually how they got in and got lots of the information that they ended up leaking. And also with ransomware attacks and so many of the other kind of attacks that have been going on, often the vector that is used is IoT. So shouldn't we be a little bit scared about distributing networks of IoT sensors if they're going to have these similar vulnerabilities? And I take you to this wonderful example from this morning, these wonderful cloud pet toys. If you remember, the way that they work is that the parent records their voice, and say a child is playing with a toy, and the toy then says this the parent's voice back. I don't know about you, but I can't think of anything more scary than a cuddly toy speaking in a Scottish accent. I don't think I would want my daughter to be playing with one of these. Maybe they're peculiarly fitting for the American market. But of course, they also had a bunch of vulnerabilities to them, including my favorite, to pair to the cuddly toy over Bluetooth, you squeezed its leg. There's a great security there. Now, cloud pets are scary enough, but you might know if you follow things like TechCrunch, there's a bunch of startups that are now producing toys that are walking and moving around your house. There's also recent work on using deep neural networks to synthesize human voice, and they have a very high accuracy rate of imitating people's voices. So I present to you surely the world's biggest nightmare, cuddly toys walking around your house speaking in a Scottish accent. And we do have to worry about this. Who is going to misuse our IoT data? When we've got these systems that are collecting data, how are we going to deal with the fact that that these systems are not always going to be in our control? My argument's a little bit different from, I think, from Alistair's this morning, because I don't necessarily see these things as about saying how developers are wrong or saying what problems they have, but that when we design these systems, we have these dilemmas, don't we? How much time can we spend on making them secure? How much time can we spend on worrying about how they might be misused? And this is the dilemma, because I think there's so many opportunities for reality mining for these IoT sensors, but this always has to be balanced with what might go wrong. Clearly, hackers are something that we have to worry about. But I take this approach that it's actually a little bit more like the body's immune system. We're always going to have intrusions, we're always going to have hackers, but we have to find some kind of homeostasis where we can minimize the damage that they do. Unfortunately, pretty much every device that you can get off the shelf now has a zero-day vulnerability. And facing up to that gives us this real kind of, I think, a real challenge. It doesn't mean that we should not have any IoT at all. Surely if we believed that, we wouldn't be here. But we have to sort of be realistic about the dangers and try and see how we can deal with them. And in fact, I think some of the most scary issues around hackers are not necessarily that the ones that we hear about in the media, but the ones that are ongoing, the intrusions that are ongoing where the hackers are clever enough not to have anybody find out about their intrusions. I mean, it's seriously possible that many of our mobile phones in this audience, the microphones might well be live. Similarly, we have these dilemmas around government and the role that government can play. And I get really scared about the idea that we might be putting out large networks of IoT sensors that the government could access. Way back in the time of the Patriot Act, one of the big concerns was about collecting phone data. And that seems really quite quaint now, doesn't it? Because it's not just our phone calls that we have to worry about, but every conversation that we have that might possibly be accessed by government. This isn't to say that government shouldn't be allowed to access this or that this will never happen. But again, that these are these dilemmas that we have to deal with on a case-by-case basis. But we have to realize that any IoT sensor that we're building, clearly the government has a right to access it and make use of that data. But maybe the people who we need to worry most about misusing that data are ourselves. History is replete of examples of people being misled by over-focusing on their data. From the Vietnam War to Hillary Clinton's re-election campaign, you can find lots of examples of cases where, by overly focusing on the data, the bigger picture was missed. And that's actually one of my worries about having these large networks and collections of sensor data, that we'll end up getting misled by that data and we'll lose track of where we are. One kind of example I find very revealing is the Tesco's club card. Now, you might well know this story. You might know that Tesco was one of the first retailers to have a loyalty card. And indeed, the initial launch of the loyalty card propelled them to be the top retailer in the UK and actually one of the top retailers in the world. You might have heard this phrase, data is the new oil. This was coined by one of the designers of the Tesco's club card system. But where is Tesco's today? Just a few years ago, they declared one of the largest losses of any organization in the UK. In one year, they managed to lose £5 billion. And how did they do this? Because they lost track of the bigger reality that they were in. They could use their Tesco's club card to do incredibly clever things like adjusting the temperature of freezers in their supermarkets to save energy, and they could work out if that had any impact on the purchasing of goods. It turned out that they could actually bring the temperature of the store and the freezers pretty much closer to each other, saving lots of energy without having any impact on their sales. So they could do these technically very clever things like this, but they missed out on long-term movements in how people buy things and how things shop in the UK and elsewhere, which was essentially the growth of convenience stores and also online shopping. So Tesco's, even though they had this great data, they sort of missed the bigger picture by over-focusing on that. I really like this talk by Masih Kegelowski. I recommend that you can check it out. It's at idlewords.com/talks. And he has this argument about data as toxic waste. So it actually fits quite well with the idea of data as the new oil, because as we know, oil is a quite difficult substance, isn't it? It causes a lot of damage as well as creates great opportunity. And his argument is that the data you have inside your organization is a liability. The government can come for it, hackers can come for it. It's actually like a kind of toxic waste that you have to manage. And so rather than thinking about all the great opportunities that data provides you, maybe we should be thinking about it as the dangers it has as a form of toxic waste. And I go back to these fellas talking to us. Very simple changes in how the cloud pets worked deletion of data, which of course is now in some ways going to be mandated. Deletion of data could have prevented many of the problems and the issues that came from the use of these toys. But of course, we might ask ourselves, did we really need to build these toys in the first place? So I'll conclude on just kind of some kind of points again. With EU regulations, we're moving much more to taking privacy through design much more seriously, designing privacy into our systems, and also, of course, thinking centrally about how much we need to delete data and the right to be forgotten. But I don't necessarily see this as all good. There's always the chance that this also has many chilling effects, that it can prevent real innovation from happening. And the first half of this talk, where I talked about some of the opportunities that we can get from IoT sensors, I think we want to kind of balance those opportunities maybe with some of the dangers that come from possibly those chilling effects. We've just started a new project, which is looking at the ethics of sensors, which is trying to understand how are we going to make those decisions, how in a usable way are we going to be able to make decisions about what our sensors record, how we analyze that data, and how, of course, we then go on to store that data. Some of the ways that we are helping organizations imagine and think about those challenges is through techniques like design fiction. So this is one most recent one that we through a process where we conducted with the city of Stockholm, which is trying to see what challenges having data collection by the city might have. And again, not shy away from dealing with some of the maybe slightly dystopian visions that might come out of the challenges that we have with data in the future. This piece and also the IKEA catalog, they're available up on our website. So, three things I talked about today. Talked a little bit about our research at Mobile Life. I do encourage you to go and check out some of the videos that we have there of some of our systems. I've also dug in a little bit and talked about the opportunities I think that IoT sensors and reality mining give us. And also, I've talked a little bit about some of the dangers I think typified most nicely with these cuddly toys speaking to you in Scottish. Thank you very much.
Well, I have no cuddly toys, but I have a friendly panel for you, so let's go sit down and talk to them. Now it's your turn to take the solo chair. Hope you will feel equally comfortable there. I kind of like Scottish, though. I think it's a cute accent. I have a hard time seeing I would be feeling very threatened almost in any way in Scottish. Panelists, what are your immediate thoughts?
So Barry, I presume you've seen the two Scottish guys in the lift trying to get up to floor 7, yeah? Let's put that aside. I'm the first to agree with you on the fact that I'm a little skeptic on the fact that data might be the new oil. I think data is real time. It's here and now. And as oil, as we all know, it takes time to collect, to store, to refine, and eventually to use. IBM talks a lot about mining the dark data, which is 80% of this data we collect we don't even actually use. But my question to you is, could you expand a little bit more on the toxic waste bit? Because I really thought that was very interesting.
Yeah, so I'll tell you a little bit of a story that maybe illustrates a little bit about that, which is I mentioned that sort of continuous speech recognition project. So we had people wearing mics, we recorded everything they said with their permission. We went through and we checked whether they were okay with sharing every different conversations and those who were in the conversations with them. And our first attempt to analyze it, we plugged it into Google's online speech recognition algorithm. And we got a whole bunch of swear words back and really toxic phrases. And we were really confused about what was going on. Until we realized back then, Google trained its speech recognition algorithm on search terms. So it was actually trying to analyze the speech conversation that we had as if it was search terms. And so it was giving us kind of garbage out. And so then we had to go and use another speech recognition service to get anywhere with that kind of data. Data is only what you make it. And so I think the one thing about this oil metaphor is that it needs to be refined. And of course, toxic waste is something that you need to treat. So I think that it's not also a case of just deletion, as if that was ever easy. We don't just delete the lines in the database. We have to refine data to make it safe. And I think that's the way in which this toxic waste analogy is useful.
But isn't it the same with all sorts of analysis when it comes to data? I mean, the term big data is not used very much anymore. And it was only 2 years ago that was what everybody was saying. But getting a lot of data, acquiring a lot of data is always easier than actually understanding it. I mean, anybody who's been working in collecting information knows that. So how do we distinguish at this point? I mean, you said we're collecting data without even knowing what we're going to be doing with it. How do we distinguish if we're a startup, if we're beginning to do something and we're getting some data that we do need and some that we don't? How are we going to store it? How are we going to treat it? Can you give any hands-on advice to the people in the room running startups that have to deal with this on an everyday hands-on level?
One of the luxuries we have at being at universities, that, as I say, we can hire social scientists and we can have them working with us, and they've got many years of experience with working with those kind of data and trying to understand human needs and human passions and how they impact. It's much harder in startups, but of course, sometimes inspiration and can come from immersing yourself in the data and different approaches where you're analyzing that data in different ways. So I always tell people, try and be heterogeneous in how you're looking at your data. So one example, for example, is video recordings of people using your system can be incredibly useful, although they're just very difficult to actually get sense of. But getting as close to the data as possible, difficult though that can be, is really, I think, key to getting the insights that you need.
And I think data can be surprising sometimes. We did a trial with a very famous watch company, a very expensive one, and they wanted to measure footfall into their shops. But being that this was in Germany, they couldn't, you know. So they basically angled the camera to the feet, and therefore footfall. They found something really weird was that actually the people who were buying the very expensive, very famous watches weren't actually the people with very nice leather shoes. The people who were buying them had trainers on, probably quite dirty ones as well, because they felt comfortable with themselves and they knew that they had the money and they could go buy the watch. So data is interesting, but it's also very fresh.
I'd like to add to that just in terms of what kind of data you should collect and so on. It seems like in the past it's been this big data. I hate that expression itself. It seems like it's the value is in the amount of data and how much you can collect. And we have a lot of clients focusing on collecting a lot of data and we'll use it later for some kind of value. And that won't come by itself. So I think that kind of really thinking it through what you're going to use it for instead of just trying to collect as much as possible is like a good start.
No, Google is still there, though. I mean, they discontinue services that don't help the database. I mean, if there's something there, not short of not making money or not necessarily important, but if it doesn't contribute to that to the vast database, we're not going to be doing it. And that's probably that old way of thinking still. Let's just gather it, and then we'll see.
Yes, and I think the difference is if you're a small startup, you can't afford just storing it and waiting, spending tons of resources and finding some kind of value later on. It's you have to be planning on what do you want to achieve with that data that you collect. So,
go ahead.
I have a question just connecting to it in terms of GDPR coming next year and companies thinking more about kind of how they can give data back to the user. Have you kind of heard anything? Is that coming in terms of IoT and collecting data for? Are they thinking about that?
Oh God, there's a conference in its own right, isn't it? And I think I'm just worried.
We're too.
Regulation often doesn't have the effects, I guess, they're intended. So And I know I'm not alone in saying this, and I know we have worries that, you know, the regulations that led to the cookie pop-ups weren't intended. And so I think there's really a worry about the unintended consequences. And as much also that just maybe whole ranges of applications might be so difficult that they die off as well now, particularly a lot of around the social aspects of technology. So I have worries, but we'll see.
Yeah, I wanted to ask exactly that, because you talked about the scary aspects of data that we all see and the fact that regulations can stifle innovation. So have you seen any developments in this area? Are there pushes for the industry to monitor itself?
I start with my students, because I think that being ethical shouldn't be this big heavyweight thing. It's like, you don't steal, you don't murder people. You know, there's this something that actually has to start, I think, from your education. And so we work very much with our students to try and inspire that in them. And ethics is so much about, sort of seems to have this idea that it should slow things down. But I think that it can actually be an impetus for very different kinds of applications and very different ways of building IoT systems. Maybe IoT systems that fit different needs than what we're used to thinking about.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah. We are going to take questions, of course, if anybody feels up for one. There is going to be some time, though, to mingle around, because we have some serious fika coming up just outside. And just to make sure that you're not going to get poisoned or anything, I've been out trying some of the stuff. I will especially recommend, and I can't wait to translate this, I will especially recommend the cookie called Kärleks Mums. Love Yummy is the actual translation I decided myself, what we need to call it in English. Chocolate, coconut, all good stuff that you're all going to get to go to get pretty soon. But let's see if there's a question first before we let everybody go to have the love yummy.
Otherwise, I have one.
All right, go ahead.
Yeah, and just kind of connecting back to Alexander's product, it's a nice product in terms of the design, that it's seamless, that you don't have to do anything about it. I think we heard a lot of scary examples of teddy bears being connected and so on. It seems like it's a race just connecting things. Do you have any positive examples of seamless IoT products that actually add some kind of value that help people? Do you have some favorite product that you could just mention?
Yeah, the video.
Okay, the video.
Yeah, I think that the important thing in consumer IoT, which is its own different challenges, is that I think, again, it's about designing for human values. So I think that systems that support us being parents, that support us being children, that look at our family relationships and our relationships with others, rather than maybe setting, you know, particular goals that we have to aim for. And I think that's something that we've tried to hold to inspire the sort of work that we've done in this center. And it's hard, of course, because there's a certain, you know, you build a technology that follows on from a previous one, so you'll make it, you know, so 20% better. Building systems that go for different human values is really quite difficult, and I think Alexander's example is a great one there. Yeah, so
I know that many of you have been captured by the presentations that we've heard today, and I've been looking into the website, which is iotconf.se. There's actually some space still available for tomorrow's workshops. There's an additional fee for that, but it may be worth your while, your time, and your money to check it out. So if you go to iotconf.se, if you feel like you want to spend your day tomorrow thinking about this use and getting a little more hands-on, then you can. Okay, so it says in the schedule that we're going to be back here 3:40 for the very last session. Let's be timely about that, or maybe a little even earlier, because after that, you know, I mentioned there's going to be drinks of a different kind than coffee, so we can't wait for that either. So see you back in a bit. Thank you.